Good afternoon and welcome to this Premier Skills discussion about advancing the women participation in football. I hope you all had a fantastic weekend, especially if you're a fan of the Gypsy King and saw the manner in which he destroyed Deontay Wilder. If we destroy this discussion the same way and get that kind of advancement, I think we should all be mightily pleased with the work we'll have done. I am Ismail Dakaba Chigongo, your moderator for this afternoon. I hope everyone, wherever you are, it's afternoon, so I'm assuming that at least no one is joining this discussion and it's morning, wherever they are. So this discussion, Premier Skills in partnership with Soccer Without Borders and FUFA, have organized this panel discussion on advancing female participation in football in Uganda. The event will mark the day of the International Day of the Girl Child, which has been celebrated in many parts of the country. It comes on the back of the national women's teams, that is the under 20 and the Crested Cranes, which is a senior women's team, competing in the COSAFA Women's Championship for the senior team, and then the under 20 team that is trying to fight for a ticket to qualify for the 2022 World Cup that will be in Costa Rica. That team, the under 20 team, has been able to knock out Kenya to move to the next stage. So something we are going to discuss, I'm very glad that we have FUFA people here because the participation we are going to discuss will go way beyond girls getting to the national team, because not all of them get to the national team. Only a small percentage of the girls that play football in this country will get an opportunity to represent the country. But what is it that will give them something to look back and say, the time I played football, this is what I gained as an individual? Are they better persons? Are they better footballers? Those are some of the questions that we are going to answer, as we hope that some of these girls and women who participate in football eventually do contribute to their communities. I'm glad to say that we are going to have several speakers. We are joined by Miss Rebecca Welch, who is a consultant for the Premier League Charitable Fund. We also have the Premier Skills participant and coach, Lydia Stephens Mukisa, will be joining us. Then we have the Director of Football Development from the Federation of Uganda Football Associations, FUFA, Mr. Ali Mwebe. And then we have a member of the Uganda Olympic Committee, who is also chairperson of the Gender Equality and Diversity Commission, Ms. Rosette Rayson-Mayer. She knows a thing or two about women's participation in sports because she's been a competitor at the biggest stages in the world. Started in Premier Skills in football, but in another sport, I think she will tackle that. She starts to speak. You'll get to learn that. I'll probably request that whoever gets a chance to speak, you feel you're able to utilize your time. And we are going to start with Ms. Rebecca Welch, who is going to speak for 15 minutes. And our major topic is going to be how female participation advances the game of football. This is a perspective from the Premier League and initiatives of helping the girl child take part in football. That's going to be a center of what she's going to be talking about. But to start, we are going to start by her telling us about her journey as a Premier League football consultant. Many of us would understand Manchester United, we understand Arsenal, and all these other teams that do take part in the Premier League, which is by far the most popular league, football league in the world. But now, a consultant for the Premier League, What's that, Rebecca? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can everybody hear me yet? Yeah, okay. Yeah, and thank you very much for that introduction. As Ismail said, I'm a consultant for the Premier League Charity Fund, which is an organisation within the Premier League who funds community programmes and education programmes across the UK to help engage participation in sport. But that's only one part of my job. So the other part of my job is I am a football referee in the English Football League. So from this year, I officiate in League One and League Two as a referee. And the reason I came on board with the Premier League Charity Fund was to try and engage more girls in sport, particularly in refereeing. So I started being a referee when I was 27, so quite late, considering you can train as a referee in England when you're 14. And really got into refereeing because I enjoyed playing football and I wanted to make my career last longer within the sport. So I became a referee. Now, 11 years on, it's my full-time job. So very fortunate to be involved in the professional game within England. So yeah, that's a little bit about my background. In April last year, I became the first female to referee in the English Football League. So a bit of history in England for that one. But the work I done with the Charity Fund was really centred around girls' participation. And I had a vision of, let's get more young girls involved in refereeing. So in England, we have around... Can I just check, is there some slides going to be put up, Jack, for me to speak through? Are the slides up? Okay, that's great. So in England currently, we have around 32,000 referees trained up. Of that number, only around 7% are female. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to understand why this figure was so low. So in England now, we have the Women's Professional League and the Women's Super League. So we have teams like Manchester United, Manchester City, Arsenal, Chelsea, all who have women's teams who compete in the professional league. So we done some investigation, and what we found out that was refereeing within England was very male dominated. So if you turn the telly on and you watch a Premier League game, the referee is male, the assistant referee is a male, with the exception of one, Sean Marcellus, who is the female assistant referee in the Premier League. So we looked at this and we thought, why is this? Why do we not attract girls into refereeing? And I think it was quite simple. In England, you become a referee if your parent has been a referee, if your sister has been a referee, if your brother has been a referee. If nobody you know has been a referee, that appetite is not there for people to become referees. So what we said we'll do is, okay, let's go into the Premier League Charity Fund funds 94 clubs within England. Okay, they give them funding to go out in the community and deliver free sports sessions for underprivileged girls, boys, from different backgrounds. So we said, okay, let's go in and let's educate not just girls, but educate girls and boys on the role of the referee. What we didn't want to do is just say to every child we come into contact with, let's go and train to be a referee. We wanted to give them an idea of what it's like to be a referee, because everybody's dream is to be a football player. And we understand that. We understand that every little girl now in England and every little boy wants to be the next Lucy Bronze, wants to be the next Cristiano Ronaldo. But we also understand that only a small percentage of people make it to represent the national teams, as we said before. So we decided to put the referee project together to give them a real insight into what it's like to be a referee. And that was more centered around girls, because what we wanted to do is we wanted to use role models like myself, like Sean Massey, who have lived experience of being a referee. So go in and give a workshop of an hour and really let them know about your journey and about what it takes to be a referee. And just give them an option into a different pathway into sport. Now, refereeing is heavily involved in football, obviously, but it also gives the girls the opportunity to expend life skills. So leadership skills, leadership qualities. Also in England, we get paid to be a referee. So once you've done your qualification, you can go out and you can earn money by refereeing games. So there was also that little bit of a employability linked with being a referee. So we delivered Over the last 2 years, we've delivered a lot of workshops to clubs. We've engaged over 600 participants, half of them which are girls, which have been received really well. And we're currently now running, now that COVID is allowing us, because COVID stopped us for quite a bit of time. But now, from this year, from June, we are allowed to run referee courses. So we are putting on referee courses for them individuals who have sat through the referee workshop, gained an insight, and then decided that they want to give refereeing a try. I think in England now, we have the female pathway in refereeing. So if a young girl or a young woman wants to become a referee, they can referee solely in the women's game. They don't have to referee in the male game. But if they do want to referee in the male game, then that is also an option. So that's a little bit of the work I've been doing with the PLCF over the last 2 years. Just moving on from the referee project, where the PLCF implemented the Changemakers Programme in 2020 and 2021. This is a programme that is jointly funded between the Premier League, the Premier League Charity Fund and Sport Relief. And it engages in the Premier League Kicks programme, which is our community-based programme, and the PL Inspires programme, which is the education-based programme. It is a female leadership and mental health project, so it's engaging 100% female attendance, and it's been run through 37 clubs within the PLCF funding. And the project's really there for the clubs to identify groups of girls to come in and develop their personal skills, their leadership qualities, and also raise awareness around mental health and gender equality. So this new initiative is running from June 2021 all the way up to April 2022. We've already got some clubs who have started. So they've started engaging the girls, delivering the sessions which were delivered to the trainers by UNITAR back in June and July. And like I said, a lot of them sessions are already up and running in the club. It gives the girls an insight into leadership, as we've already said, and also making them aware of their mental health, which is something that is really important as the girls get older. They're delivered in various settings, so they're delivered through sports, different activities, also through workshops, mentoring and training, because the ultimate goal is to make a network of girls and women as young leaders, so hopefully that eventually they might go on to work within the PLCF programmes within the clubs. And it's just kind of to create an awareness around females about leadership and how they'll learn. So that's kind of in a nutshell what the PLCF are doing towards girls' participation, something that we think is very important and something we really feel is important. The use of role models is very important within that. I'm a great believer in thinking that if you can't see it, you can't be it. So I think it's really important that as a role model myself to young girls, we go in and we speak to the young girls about our jobs, about how sometimes they can be tough, but how the rewards, if you put a lot of hard work in, are there. And also that participation in football doesn't mean just playing football. There are a lot of job roles in football that you can now go into.
Thank you, Becky. Are you going to open a slide or? Becky, as you spoke, I waited to hear something on some of the examples of initiatives that the Premier League has taken, because I had you go on about to get into refereeing. Most of them maybe have a sister or a mother who was in refereeing or family or something. So has the Premier League been able to go to communities and speak to girls within school and tell them about the good, about them getting involved in football when they do not see anyone like them? If your parent took you to a stadium, you're likely to find people singing Mohamed Salah or singing, how then do you get these girls to join?
Yeah, so we made the referee workshop available to all of the 94 clubs that we engage with. So a lot of the clubs, what they do is they deliver girls-only sessions. So they know that girls are more comfortable in a certain way. It's all females. So we offered that workshop out to them, which meant me going in and talking about my role as a referee. Part of the workshop was a bit of an interactive section. So we did a VAR presentation where the girls were the referees and we'd play the clips and they had to make a decision. So they really got a feel about not just being a referee, but also kind of how difficult it was. And my main remit for this workshop was to not make everybody want to be referees. But a lot of these girls play football. So for them to have an understanding about how difficult leadership roles in refereeing can be. So if at the end of the workshop, the girls didn't want to be a referee, they had a little bit more knowledge around the sport they play week in, week out.
Okay. What else in terms of football and premier skills did the girls want to be other than refereeing? Were you able to convince them about all the other things that are around football? Because many people may think that football is that small, but it's actually much wider, that you may be a girl and join the game and may not be necessarily either as a footballer or as a referee. There are other opportunities within football.
Yeah, definitely. I think, especially through COVID, a lot of the delivery from the Premier League Charity Fund from the clubs has gone online. So this has given the clubs the opportunity to get, again, role models coming in, talking about different roles in football. So a lot of football clubs have had coaches, female coaches coming in, female strength and conditioning coming in, because that's very big now within football. So kind of highlighting, we did an event with Watford where we went in and we've done a careers event about different careers in sports, whether that's an analyst for looking at how far people run in a game, or whether that was a coach, like I said, a referee's point of view, a sports scientist's point of view, physiotherapy. Because now, I think you're right, when you look back at football, there are so many opportunities available to be employed within football. That doesn't necessarily mean you're on the grass at 3 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon playing the game. So, yeah, I think COVID gave us this opportunity to really engage, you know, girls and boys in these important discussions that you potentially might not make it as a footballer, but have you thought about the other list of jobs that could still keep you involved in the sport you love?
Sure. Rebecca, maybe finally you could share something to do with the doctors and strength and conditioning. Because when I watch football on television now, there's a lot of ladies doing that job. The physiotherapists, the doctors who run when a player goes down injured. Has this been deliberate by the Premier League or its individual clubs that now you have a lot more ladies working with some of these players on the medical side?
I'm not really sure from a PL point of view. I think I could give my opinion as a referee in the women's game. You know, we, especially now in the Women's Super League, we see a lot more female coaches and managers within the Super League, which is great. Obviously, the Women's League in England has really grown fast. There's a great opportunity for girls to be professional. And like I say, I think I've noticed it more through the women's game that we're getting a mix of more females coming through. We have a lot more females studying at university to go into specific sports industries like football, like rugby. So I think a lot of girls are seeing the opportunity that, you know, they can go into football as something different and really now focusing on that study to get the qualification to go in there.
Sure. Thank you. Recently, I was watching a Women's Super League game where Barcelona beat Arsenal. And Arsenal have not lost again since February. So I was partly celebrating that because I'm not a big fan of the Arsenal, but I was also delighted a few weeks ago and I saw Chelsea beat Manchester United 5-0. So I'm always following and I'm always amazed by how many strides the women's game is taking in the UK. Maybe not too far from now, as England try to win a Women's World Cup. Of course, they won't win the men's very soon. We'll have to stay with 1966. Maybe the women's is one they can win eventually at some point. And by the time they do, Uganda will also have qualified for the Africa Women's Cup of Nations for the very first time because we haven't made those strides yet. Rebecca, something very important that you think you want to share before Lydia Cobb brings it home?
Yeah, I just think for me, you know, I'm a big advocate of getting girls involved in sport. And I think sometimes we just have to approach it that little bit different. You know, girls are a little bit more quiet than boys. You know, they seem a little bit shy. But I think girls just take on more information. But yeah, I think it's something that we need to look at when we're delivering, being a little bit different with girls to boys. And I think that's okay because, you know, I think that's the best way you get the best out of the girls.
Thank you, Mr. Baker-Wells, for sharing consult on the Premier League Charitable Fund. I've also learned that in many places, when you put ladies in leadership, you're very likely to get very good results, more than anyone else. They tend to achieve a lot more when they put their heart to something. Lydia Stephens Mukasa, Premier League participant and coach. She's worked in the environment where I am in Uganda. I hope Lydia, you're ready, and you're going to help us understand the barriers of female participation in sports. But before you do that, you're going to tell us about your experience, yourself and your journey in football, because in my community, and not too long ago, I was involved with the local community politics. I could hardly find girls who play any sport, maybe netball for a few of them. But even those who tried to play was because of my initiative that I went there and asked some of these communities to get some kind of sport that they could play. But tell us about your journey. Then after that, you're going to take us through the barriers of females participating in a program like this across Uganda. Lydia, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Ismail. My name is Lydia, I'm 25, and I'm a human rights activist. I'm a coach educator with Premier Skills and also a child safety and protection officer with Sokolo Soccer Academy. Is my voice okay?
Okay. Lydia, go on.
Well,
you have our attention.
Started way back. Oh, thank you very much. My football started way back when I was 3 years old. And I started to play during that age, like kind of playing with a ball. Then went through all my primary playing. Then I joined St. Mary's Naweru. Later, I joined Makerere Shimak. After Makerere, I joined Gafford Girls Football Team. Yes, so far those are the teams I managed to play for by that time.
There must have been, Lydia, while you're coming through, and you said you played with the boys, so there weren't many other girls to look at, older than you were playing. What are those barriers? Some of them could be personal. Others could be those you've seen that have prevented other ladies from participating.
Yeah, well, some of the barriers were social, physical, and personal, but some of the personal were a lot of people, like a lot of girls, and especially young girls, lack confidence. They lack confidence, and also sometimes safety. Some of the sports facilities are not safe for the girls to engage. Like you can look at a lot of pitches in Kampala, Wakiso, and the Greater Masaka. You can find a pitch, but there's no a safe space where a girl can maybe take off their attires and then come again and maybe put on their jerseys and then come to the pitch. Some of the physical, of course, most of the sports facilities in Kampala, they're not space, like they're not safe. They are rough surfaces and also the changing areas. And then in the social, there are a lot of social barriers which actually affect women and girls from participating, like what the society look at a girl child. Most of the society think that a girl can actually not play football because they think this is a male-dominated game. And also a role of a housewife. People think a woman's supposed to be a wife, like a housewife, like it's a weaker sex. You can do this, you can do that, and also poor sponsorship. And some of the barriers, there are those barriers which actually inside football, which are outside football. And inside football, we're having a sports administration, which is actually male-dominated. We're having sexual harassment. I, for one, am a victim, and I'm sure a lot of girls can't actually just come up and speak on this, but we are facing sexual harassment by coaches and sports administrators. And a few people just, like most of the girls, are moving out of the game because no one is advocating for the safe spaces for their participation. So this is making them move out of the game or lack the courage to move on. And also there are a few events which are purposely planned for the girls to engage in. According to FUPA, actually, you can see like there are a few actually engagements, like events. The male team has the Kabyabaganda football tournament. There's Stanbic, there's Uganda Cup, there's Kagame Cup, where the male teams actually in the Premier League of Uganda participate, regardless the girl side. And also there's less media coverage and also lack of role models and also less opportunities on the girl side. And there's also lack of well-trained coaches on menstrual hygiene. We are seeing a lot of male coaches coaching or actually heading women and girls team, but they lack knowledge on menstrual hygiene. And this is making a lot of women and girls drop out because they cannot pray during their menstrual periods, and they are not so open with the coaches to talk about it. And also, there's discrimination and prejudice. A lot of male coaches, actually, I'm sorry if I'm speaking a lot on male coaches, but because when you look at the Uganda National League, the women's elite league, most of the coaches are male, like the head coaches. And then there are some barriers, actually, which are outside football, where we're finding what we call stereotypes. From the community, there's also family commitment and gender responsibilities. There's culture and school because they think a girl child cannot play or have so much time in at the pitch because they have to go to school. When you don't go to school as a girl child, what will you do after your soccer journey? And also, women face. Can't do this. Now you see how your body looks like. Recently, the president of Tanzania just made a statement that women in sports are non-sexually attractive to get married. They're not wife materials because when you do a lot of things, your body changes. Then you're not... I think if we actually get... If women and girls get such negative perceptions... This is really a bad lose there. Ismail, there's also which came due to COVID-19. And some of these there's a decline in performance because now it has been 2.5 years of COVID-19 and then a girl child is not at the pitch. There's a few. We are seeing unwanted pregnancies. We are seeing depression. We are seeing anxiety, which is actually leading to mental health. And remember, in Uganda, we have a few girls and women who are really participating in football. So if such challenges came in, we are really losing out on the number of girls and women which are participating. And also, I want to talk about discrimination by coaches. Women are discriminated because most women, when they train, their body changes, and then they are misjudged by coaches. There's also unwanted pregnancies, which has actually raised due to COVID-19 and forced marriages. Because I know in Uganda, I know you hear, you may not hear, but I'm sure you think this on the televisions, how we are seeing a lot of number of girls who have been impregnated in the COVID-19 time. These are the girls in the slums which we have been trying to motivate to come through to the pitch and maybe showcase, maybe engage, include them. And then due to COVID-19, they are moving out. So those are some of the challenges I have, all the barriers which are actually affecting a lot of women and girls in the participation of football.
Okay. Sorry. Thank you. Thank you very much, Lydia. I was muting because from where Lydia was speaking, there was a lot of background. I think there is people in the neighborhood where she is, and there was a bit of noise. Anyway, so I didn't want to fall victim to the same thing. I think from one of the things that all of us on this panel could understand from what Lydia was saying, I've had a lot of cannot. Girls are told their entire lives that you cannot do this, you cannot do this. I've not had a lot of communication from those who are in charge, either as parents or communities or administrators or coaches, telling them that you can actually do this. I hear a lot of cannot, girls cannot. And you know, such a mindset is very, very difficult, and we need to start to work on changing it. I also noted, I think for everyone here, you must also have heard about a very touchy subject of sexual harassment. That's a very touchy subject. And I'm not one of those who thinks some of these conversations have got to start being shared publicly, because then the ladies start to be judged publicly. That's why many times I want this discussion to happen in private with someone they have a lot of comfort in speaking to, whether it's a parent, whether it's a sister, someone they can confide in. That's why sometimes I'm thinking, even those who come out publicly and are able to give stories about harassment should do it in their convenience, in their comfort, because sometimes it's extremely touchy as a subject. But thank you very much. And this is the best time. And I like the fact that Emily and Carol, who got this together, had a person from FUFA speaking right after Lydia has spoken. Because one of the things that Lydia touched when she spoke was the issue to do with competitions. We do not have enough competitions for the women. The men play all these competitions all year round, but the women do not. So, Mr. Ali Mwebe, what are the strategies that you as FUFA or as Uganda are taking to increase the level of female participation in sport? It's a very wide subject, but the floor is now yours. What are we doing to ensure that there are more women playing?
Thank you very much, Ismael. First of all, I bring you the greetings of the FUFA president, Honorable Engineer Moses Magugo, and the CEO Edgar Watson. They are aware that this forum is going on. I take also opportunity to thank the organizers. I really feel it feels nice when I'm discussing women football, because in FUFA, this is the directorate department which I head at the secretariat, and this is where women football is domiciled. I've heard a lot from Lydia, and I'm very happy that she's one of our players in one of our leagues, the new leagues that we have created, the FUFA Women Elite League that we created in 2015. Maybe I need to give her assurance and everyone that things are going for better. And one thing I want to tell you, Ismail, women can. For us, we believe ladies or women can. We don't believe that they can't. We believe they can, and you have a lot of things. I've put up a slide. I don't know if the controller can be able to give me the slide. Maybe to answer Lydia, we have a couple of competitions. Remember, Ismail, I was head of competition one time in FUFA before I went into football development. And we have there the first tier league. We have created first tier FUFA Women Super League. Then we have a second tier women FUFA Women Elite League. FUFA Women Super League is 10 clubs. Then Women Elite League is 16. Then we are creating a third tier in the regions, the way men's football is. Because, you know, it is Premier League for men, then big league for second division, then regional league is a third division. We are doing the same for women. We had decided playing regional league, save this COVID pandemic. Then we also introduced the cup competition. You are aware we have for women's cup. Then we now... A club which wins our league nowadays, they are representing the country. We had just had Lady Doves going to Nairobi to play on the continent. Then we, in terms of national team football, we have created the three fully functional national teams that even now they are very active. The under 17 national team, the under 20 national team, which just eliminated Kenya the other day, Friday. Then we also have the senior national team, which just came back from South Africa for Safa tournament. I can't see my slide. I don't know. I can't see it here. Yeah, maybe you can play. So I can open it from here. If it has issues. Yeah, the vision of FUFA is to be number one football nation in Africa on and off the field. And for us, if we set a vision to be number one, women football in FUFA is integrated by the leadership of FUFA believes a lot in women football. And when you say to be number one, again, you want to be number one in male football and women football. Then the mission, our mission is to develop the game, protect and promote the game. And again, a lot we are doing again in the side of women football. We have done a lot of trainings, of course, in the area of development and then youth, because we are doing school football. Then we are doing now we are going to primary school, save the pandemic which came in. You remember we did the primary school tournament for the first time for boys in 2019. So we are going for girls, the pandemic set in. But again, we are very committed. We shall do these programs. Then, maybe I need to open it from here. Now, FUFA's strategy now, we have what you call the hat trick, and this hat trick also covers women football. All these focus areas you're seeing, we want to do governance, as I'll tell you, even women football is included because it is integrated inside there. Governance, sport, want to do business, then hardware, we mean infrastructure. Lydia mentioned about the issue of girls not being safe when changing. That's one of the areas that has puzzling us because grounds in Uganda are really bad, especially Kampala. But again, FUFA has a strategy, what we want to do to improve infrastructure. Then the stakeholders, internal and external, again, we mean also women football. And we want to do this in three objectives, which you call a hat trick, to achieve world class of sporting excellence, including women football. We want to be excellent team in women football. Then we want to expand the game of football to reach every home state. Again, we mean the girl child. As we're going down to get the boy child, even the girl child. then you want to create a professional football industry, not leaving women football, especially our two tier. Now, last weekend, we just had the FIFA, we had a club licensing workshop. Club licensing is a tool used to ensure that clubs professionalize or get structures. So we did the two workshops for our tier one and tier two. Again, all these initiatives are pulling women football, and you want to bring it also in light. Now we have a strategy. We have a FIFA women football strategy. It is based or it is built on four pillars. One is to improve women football league and national team. It's the reason I told you now we have the first tier, second tier, third tier, and the cup competition, because we want to do the national teams and also the leagues. Now we are introducing, together with FIFA, club licensing, because we want professionalized women football clubs. Then you want to increase women involved in women football, in football. There, in next slide, I will show you. In governance, gone a time when you used to have only two women representatives in the top organ, which makes rules for a game of football, which is the General Assembly, they call it the Congress. Now, as we speak, we have 17. The number was just increased last year, the last AGM, because a decision was passed to have each and every region represented. Then you want to create revenue generating streams. Yeah, we want now also women football to start generate its revenue. You've seen now we broadcast women matches on Uganda Broadcasting Corporation, UBC TV. So all these are initiatives to pull women football. Again, you want to increase the number of girls. Now, under our objective of taking the game to each and every home state. So these are the broad objective of the strategy, and you want to achieve them. Maybe when I go to the slide of the progress, like you say in governance, we had two women, now we have 17. Then we used to depend on school football and tournaments. Now I've just explained to you, we have a three-tier league system, which is giving us 82 clubs and teams that are guaranteed of playing quality football, that is at national level. Then we didn't have players registered, but as I can speak now, about 2,180 players, and that is from 2015 when the league began. About 120 referees are registered, about 120 coaches, 139 referees, three national teams, then a representative team in the club that we just had, and it will be happening every year. Then, what are the specific strategies that you are setting to do? Of course, the other strategy, the four objectives are broken down into action plan, but allow me to mention a few of them. Of course, the strategy is there. Then we are doing a lot of programs with FIFA that are targeting FIFA and CAF, women only. For instance, we are starting to organize courses for women only. We are going to do refereeing course for women only. We are doing school football competitions and projects. Then we are doing the promotion through marketing, television of women in football. Then we are doing also streaming of matches. We want to take matches. We want to erase away the barriers. When we do FIFA Awards, Ismail always an MC there. We give the male MVP a car. Then we give the female MVP in the league a car. All these are meant to raise women football. Also, specific media campaigns, as you know, when you look at the pictures here, we are engaging sponsors. If it is a water partner and you are telling them, look, brand this water. If you are going for Women's Super League, brand it for Women's Super League. So these are some of the strategies. Back to you, Ismail.
Thank you, Ali. I like the part when you talk about the number of competitions that you've set up. But also going back to what Lydia said, reminds me yesterday, I'm part of a Sunday League football team. Yes. And I'm part of a Sunday League football team.
All right.
We play many Sundays. And I remember yesterday we had a game and we had to change on the pitch. But we are boys. We could easily take off and stay with our bow, with our undergarments, which is a vest and something, and then put on our green jersey, which we use for the team. So it's very, it's a very touchy subject. But you know, Ali, you ignored something that is very important for you as administrators. Lydia spoke about sexual harassment. Are you, as a federation, who train coaches, who train administrators, who train executive members, highlighting this as a problem? Do we have a system as FUFA presently, which is able to handpick someone who has allegations against them and deal with them either internally or maybe seek the support of authorities to help us with this vice of sexual harassment? Because Lydia was very passionate when she spoke about it.
And it is very unfortunate. I heard she said she was a victim, of which I'm really very sorry about that. Of course, in football, we teach our people, especially male coaches, to have very high morals. Of course, you're dealing with our child, but it doesn't give you an advantage to harass the girls. So we always do the campaigns in coaching courses. We teach them. And again, we have regulations. FUFA has committees that even when you do some, you've had the people being taken in committees. But I know the sensitivity of reporting. Maybe a girl may be harassed and then she's fearing for her safety, for her future to report. But again, we are aware of this. Then we have a women football section, which is under the department I head. And we have a women football development officer, who is also a lady. And we also have a committee, a women football committee and association, which has senior women. So we always encourage these girls, in case you have issue with a coach, always seek support of these senior members. Report, of course, when it comes to us with concrete evidence, we punish. We have committees that really take action and punish.
Oh, thank you, Ali, for that submission. If you're somewhere in the discussion and you have a question, please post it. Caroline is receiving the questions and then she will be able to share. And at some point, I'm going to have these questions put back to the panel before we continue. But as we get towards that, there's someone whose job every single day with the Uganda Olympic Committee is about gender equality and diversity as a commission. She's chairperson. Ms. Rosette Sison-Mayor has also competed for Uganda in sports. So she comes with knowledge of being a sportsperson who competed in sport. And on the other side, she's also an administrator. Ms. Rosette Mayor, your topic is meant to do with the role of different stakeholders in improving female participation in sport, but you're going to start by telling us who actually these stakeholders are. Who are they? But are you doing anything about gender equality and diversity? Because some of the debates I've seen, as when I think about the Uganda Olympic Committee of Professional Sport, is women should be paid the same as men. I've seen Megan Rapinoe, the captain of the US football team. I've seen, for example, tennis, which is one of the better sports, I think. Women at the US Open are paid as the same. If you're Emmanuel Raducanu, you're paid as the same as Novak Djokovic. In some sports like equestrian, at the Olympics where I was in Japan, ladies compete against men, and they haven't seen a sport that is able to achieve that, with the exception of equestrian. So before you move into the stakeholders, what is UOC, which is a stakeholder in itself, doing to enhance equality and diversity in a commission that you head? Thank you. The floor is yours, Ms. Rosette. Rosette, please. Miss Mayor, please unmute your microphone.
My goodness. Sincere apologies. My name is Sison Rosette Mayor. And maybe I will just introduce myself. I know you want me to go into the UOC and everything, But kindly, if you could allow me, I wanted to say a little bit of what I do, and then go into the sports itself, then I would jump back into the UOC, and then I also go into the stakeholders, if that is okay with you. Is that okay? Okay. On the other side, I've worked for quite a long time, working with the European Union, with USAID, and right now I'm working with the UK AIDS, CIG. And for all these different places, I'm an advisor of human rights, conflicts, gender, children, and social protection. They differed, but it all led to the same thing. And looking at the sports bit of it, just like how Lydia was talking about, I started sports when I was very young, okay? Very young, way back when I was in primary, actually, Chitante. And I can tell you I've been on the national team for volleyball, national team for basketball, national team as an athlete. I've gone to so many of these international games that you can hear of. And I think I'm the second female in Uganda to have participated in what they call heptathlon. Now, heptathlon are 7 events within the package of athletics. And at some point, I held Uganda's national record in high jump. So I wanted to give a little bit of that so that when I'm talking, you understand where I'm coming from. Putting sports and also looking at the issues of rights, issues of gender, issues of protection. So I wanted to try to make sure that I'm going to kind of package this in a way that brings out first and foremost from my personal experience as an athlete, as a player who started very young, who have seen a little bit of what is going in, and also trying to look at the outside, working with other spheres, how it evolves and how what it brings into the sports, but also looking at UOC and what is being done. That's why I said I wanted to make sure that I introduce so that you try to get a little bit of the background where I'm coming from. First and foremost, I want us to look at the realities because yes, Ali talked of something, Lydia talked of something, and then we also had the consultant, of course, Rebecca, bringing in the international, where it is the other side. But I want us to look at the realities where we are in terms of our home here in Uganda. When you look at issues of social, cultural norms and practices and what they contribute towards what we are doing, they contribute a very big, I would say 3/4 of what affects what goes on in the field of sports, irrespective of whether it's male and female. But for the female, it even brings in what I would call inequality. Those issues, the stereotypes that Lydia was alluding to, you know, where they're looking at all, first and foremost, I'll just give you a classic example. I've seen the uniform of FUBA, and this is not really, Ali, we are not attacking. I'm just trying to bring out things, issues, isn't it? Because we are here just to look at issues. It's not really about name and shame. And for that matter, I'll try also to bring in other sports so that, you know, we look at the comparison. If you look at the uniforms that you're giving the ladies, for example, I've watched some of the games, and poor girls, they keep pulling themselves. Because when a club is buying, a club has male and female, and they are buying the jerseys, it's the same jersey they buy. Forgetting, possibly the ladies have a little bit of bigger bums or bottoms down there, or maybe the shirts wouldn't be shirts, but more of designed into ladies' uniforms. And it's not only about football. It's also actually in other sports. Other sports are even worse. If you go to volleyball, one of the things some of the girls say, they said, I'm married now. I can never go back to play volleyball because of the attires we are using. So I'm saying if we look at all the realities that are around us, the social cultural norms plays a big role into what we are doing. They now come again because today we are looking at a girl child and we are commemorating that. And then when you look at the girls, at what stage do they come in? How many girls actually front themselves and come out? Because at the end of the day, how many parents do we have that are saying by the age 2, they are going to put their girls there to play football? Stereotypes, I didn't do it. How will my neighbor look at me? And all these issues coming. And you find that by the age 7, 8, even if the girls have already tried to play with the boys, they are stigmatized in a way. That boy, they call them what? You're moving like a boy, you're bending like a boy. I mean, if it's done at that level, What does it mean? And where is it going to take this girl? Are these girls going actually to enroll in sports, whether it's going to be football, whether it's going to be the other one? And also, especially with the football, there is this bit where they start saying, oh, children, girls going into football, your muscles are going to do this. You'd rather go for swimming. It's the classic. You know, they look for the classic games where they are going to be able to do certain things. So all different things, if you look at the realities, first and foremost, they downplay a little bit of what can bring in girls at some point. Then I also go to the other reasons of, especially the teenagers. You could have some girls, for example, I know Edgar is a personal friend, but when you get where he was having the KK League, you would go to the ground and it would be full. Then the more years you go up, 8, 7, by about 11, 15, some of the girls have fallen through the cracks. What does that mean? Looking at the different, they have their different reasons why they don't play. My friend is no longer there. Oh, I have breasts now. The boys are laughing at me. The girls think it's not the in thing. You know, they have different, you know, reasons that they can give. And actually, one of the biggest I could say, especially when it comes to certain games or certain sports, and I could say also football, is the parents themselves, because they are a very key stakeholder. They can even see, there is one girl I was trying to talk to, because I use my game of basketball. I formed a club. We go to different schools. We go to different societies, our communities, all over the country, just to talk to the children. Not necessarily about basketball, but about sports and girls who are trying to enroll. And one of the things they said, oh, when you play football, your breasts disappear. It's a stereotype. I remember telling one of the girls, do you believe in God? Yes, I believe in God. I said, okay, God gave you that body. Yes, gave it to me. Then I said, maybe God will pick it up if it falls down. It was a joke, but I'm trying to bring out the realities that are out there. So even as we are trying to look at some of these things, we need first and foremost to forecast ourselves and look at what are the realities. We don't want to go defensive. We don't want to say, oh, it's not happening. When we understand that, then it's easier for us to say, how do we try to plan to go forward? Now I'll move a little bit to what is existing. We have federations. Yes, we have our FUFA, but I'll first go to all the other federations, for example. We are about 53 federations and associations of sports in Uganda, if I'm not mistaken. But out of this, it's only seven women who are in the leadership position. What does that tell you? When you go to that deputizing, including FUFA, you know who your deputy is. You know who exactly we have in a place where the women are. They don't really have those positions where we think, but I'm so glad that you're saying building capacity, coming in now, coming through the General Assembly, by and large, after some time we'll get there. But this is something that is cutting across, by the way, for all the different federations. At the end of the day, what is being done? And that brings in a little bit of what I do on my daily work, when I'm working elsewhere. Everybody says we've mainstreamed. Mainstreaming is so good. Yeah, mainstreaming is so good. But it's where you need to say specifically, we need to have two approaches, the mainstream and the specific. What can we do, for example, to say specifically, I'm targeting the girl child? Those kind of programs are not there in most of the organizations, or rather federations and associations. Even in the netball itself, for example, you find that there are issues where the men are not really brought towards the level of the women. That is in the netball federation. So what am I trying to bring out here? There are no deliberate systems that are really actually inbuilt when it comes to making sure that we understand, for example, dynamics of how girls should be handled, where about they are developing faster, knowing when to start working on them, and that kind of thing. So I thought it would be very good that I also point that one out. Then another thing, it's about, I want to link it to what Lydia was saying, building the fundamentals. And what am I talking about fundamentals, especially for that age that is very critical, around from about 10 to about 16. Fundamentals, you know, these girls with a coach who is a male is telling her to run. Possibly that's the first time she's having a cycle, and she can't explain it to the coach. Of course, now they are coming in with the senior ladies and everything. But trust me, senior ladies in most of these sports, and I can assure you, because I was there. When I was an athlete, my coach was a male. When I was a volleyballer, my coach was a male. In basketball, all my coaches were male. How would they understand how I feel? How do I go and whisper to them? They are not for crying out loud, my brother, my boyfriend, that you can't. Even your brother, you can't tell it out. Some can't even tell their boyfriends. How can they tell out what? So you find that looking at the fundamentals of how we want to handle the girls, it's not really what it is. Okay? This brings me also to the policies. Yes, you said we are doing all these different things, but our policies do not actually speak out what we are talking about. They are not enforced, or if they are enforced, somehow, somewhere, they are tilted on one side and not on the other side. I wanted to bring these ones out so that at the end of the day, by the time we get to where, how do we engage the stakeholders and why, you could understand what I'm talking about. We talked about what I would call sexual exploitation, abuse, and harassment. If you look at all the federations, including FUFA, I don't think we have a specific policy on that. Or if it's there, it's actually not enforced. One, because if it's there, each player that is coming on, I know now you've spread, you're now having approximately 80, but if you take it down to the 80, do they even know the grievance mechanism they need to follow, the system? Do they know where to go? Do they know how to report? These are things that are supposed to be kind of oriented when a player comes in. And I'll say this because I have a basketball team. And for each player who comes in, of course, they are girls, but it's easier. Each player that comes in, we say, we don't do A, B, C, D. We don't do this. We don't do the other. But these kind, most of the federations and associations, including FUFA, yes, I don't think we have a specific policy that is dealing with issues of abuse. If it's there, I'm not so sure whether it's really functional, but maybe at some point you'll be able to let me know. But otherwise, also giving to credit to most of the associations, including FUFA, we have what I would call holistic programs. Like they've said, they want to train the coaches, they want to train the coaches, referees, they want to coach the administrator. But then we go back to the social aspect that I was talking about. The women don't come out. Their programs are there, but the women don't come out. So it needs a certain approach where we try to also tap to make sure that the women also come in, because the programs are going to look so good. They're going to be there and you're going to say, yes, we've come in and we've called. Out of the 50, you're going to have 3 women. And it's going to be ticked, yes, the program came out. But how gender responsive was it? So I also wanted to make sure that I point out one out before we can go. And yes, there are so many other things that we can look at. The long-term progression of the girl child. When do we tap her? When do we put in it? Do we have specific? Because I know, for example, FUFA, have your specific ones for the young boys. And it's so good that now you're bringing on the one for the girls. But the key word is, how do we tap them in? Because the way you work at the girls is not going to be the same way. The how is going to be very important. Now, going back to a little bit of how can we work together so that afterwards I'll be able to let you know what UOC has done. We need to create what I call a coordinated and connected approach to the sporting landscape, especially for the girl child, you know, to see how best we can champion the best practice. If we get a person like Rebecca, where things have worked in the UK, yes, it's very good. We can get them. And then we try to see how they can be tailored to the situation where we are in Uganda. And some of the people we need to tap in, for example, private sector. There are so many opportunities there. But half the time, when we are fronting them, there's a tendency to front the male as opposed to the women. This is reality. Like I said, we try to bring everything to reality. And what does that mean? By the time you want to put in the ladies, this budget is so small for what the things they are going to be doing. And yet they are there. You know, the summoners, the big giants, MTNs, media houses are there. Of course, government, through the Ministry of Education, But then we are saying even the Minister of Education should also bring on board other line ministries, Minister of Health. How do we try to make sure that we engage people like them, the UNFPA, family, the UN family members? Because if we are talking about issues of ladies and they are working on issues of women, how do we try to engage with them? And also the federations and associations yourself, your fertile ground in terms of how we can tap into the programs, development programs, to make sure that they are very, very deliberate to target the girl child and to target the female to make sure that they also excel. Development partners, using sports as a driver for development, and we can work either through the sports federations or you could also work through the clubs, or you could even start with the community at the community level. And then, of course, the sports fraternity. We are looking at some of the groups that are out there, male, female, these circles that we are talking about. We need just to go there and you say, in whatever you're saving, could you save the 10,000 or whatever to sponsor this child who's in your community to at least, or to even buy a ball? I'm just trying to put it to even the smallest of the labels. And the fan base, we could try to see how we can tap in that. And then, of course, communities, very importantly, trying to make sure that we involve the parents. Let me tell you something. Most of the good talent that can be tapped is when children are very young. But remember, they need consent from their parents. And I'm talking this from experience. My daughter is the national swimming captain. I didn't do swimming. I don't like swimming. But when she came in, and this is what she wanted, I just had to make sure that I support her. So if we need to see how we can engage with the guardians, with the parents, to make sure that what we do is going ultimately to bring out the results we want and to have a big field of different people. What does the UOC does? The UOC has a strategy actually to enhance participation and leadership specifically for the ladies. And how are we trying to do that? There is through different organized existing structures. They are the schools, they are there. And they are those who are in the communities. But the thing is, the UOC doesn't necessarily sponsor or go get projects. What we do is to leverage on what is existing. For example, FUFA says they have a program that is coming up. It's going to be capacity building. We look at your program and you say, we would like you to come and be part of the facilitator. It's not monetary, but I think it's also, you can't quantify it, because if somebody comes and is going to carry out a training and is going to do it for their different leagues or different capacity building programs that you're having, it's also what a little bit of what we do. So we have that. We have programs that are running in the refugee camps and all these other different programs. Thank you so much. Back to you, Ismail.
Glad Rosette, not seen in several years. Last saw you on the court as a young journalist all those years ago. I like the eloquence, and I think you've said so many things that are gone quietly. Emily and Caroline, I think you're the people who are calling people to attend this panel. You need a raise for inviting Rosette to come here, because she said so many things that have made Ali uncomfortable. Ali, we are going to get into the questions, but there are things in there that you can pick up from what Rosette said that particularly talk about football. And you don't have to defend yourself. This panel is not a court of law. It's not a commission of inquiry. But there are things in there about people handling the girls, the coaches. She spoke about a basic, like a uniform. Surely, why should girls be struggling with their uniforms?
Actually, if I was near her, I would clap so loud. her submission has really been touching. Of course, I can't defend, because I know we are coming from the world of reality. And what we just need is joint effort. I'm just learning that they are facilitators, and I can talk to our administration for our courses that are coming. Women only, maybe we invite them to part with us. And also, and since she's coming from UOC, I'm also interested. You know, UOC, we are also under UOC umbrella as an Olympic sport. If there is a program like that one, where they have advanced, like the reporting mechanism, the procedure on how to handle sexual harassment cases, let them right federations like ours, we shall embrace, we shall give a team of our people to be trained so that this team can now again disseminate, and then the procedure maybe is adopted. There is nothing I can defend. We always welcome such ideas, and you're all working to develop especially women game. And really, you talk about the issue of jerseys, sometimes it's an oversight, no one cares, you know. Everyone think maybe the jerseys can fit. You know, these are some of the things we learn from one another, but I'm really interested in their programs. One time I was invited by your OC. There was a program we went actually we are enlightening our strategy on scouting. But now these policies on protection of girls, if they are there, we just need them to write and inform us. For us, we shall always take opportunity.
Sure. Thank you, Ali. There are some questions here that have been coming through. And this is something I want to throw this at one of you. How can we better? It's actually not about scoring fortunes. And therefore for only the best in this era of professional, okay, how can you convince girls to get into football where the target is not just scoring fortunes, where it's not about being able to throw your item and buy an iPhone 13, you know? Most of us, when we join sport, our admiration for another footballer driving a car that I may admire is the reason why I'll go and work out. It's the reason why I'll play hard for a period. But how then do you convince girls to come to the game in the era of professional football and tell them that your target should be way beyond scoring a fortune? Ali, you have a minute for that.
I'm very happy, Ismail, you've been one of the MCs at all the presenters of the prestigious FUFA Awards that happen every December. And you are aware that every December, when these awards are organized, save for this COVID year, the previous year, 2020, when it didn't have these awards, the male MVP drives that night, also the female MVP drives.
You know? Yeah, the same couple.
Initiatives we put forward to maybe the young girl who is there can be inspired by this one who is driving. But leave alone that. Now, FUFA also, we remunerate players. When they go out there and represent the country, those who are above age, of course, we don't pay underage players. We pay those who are out of the age. Of course, we remunerate, and this remuneration is also a motivation to them. And there is also opportunity, you know, football, when you start to play the national team, and for men's football, maybe the journey is long for you to start and get the national team. But for women football, the journey maybe is a little bit shorter. We always, so many girls have come in and then a little years of playing, the girl has gone to the national team. And then maybe the career starts from there. We have girls who have gone to the United States, to Europe. Now they are switching to Europe, having played in our league. They are now switching to Europe, to USA. Some of them going for scholarship. Now some I can see they are going to sign and play football. So these are some of the initiatives that are there, and maybe our media campaign need to be beefed up so that communication goes out there in full blast.
Okay, thank you, Ali. I've seen some questions, but I don't think we have the right people to respond to them. Someone, Moses here, says, I follow hashtag United, who have a ladies team in Tier 3. How can a person like me do for my two girls to get into the game? Then he also goes on to say, how can we make a mindset change for girls to pick interest in football? Really, I see many regard it as for men. I think this is what Lydia spoke about and Rosette went through repeatedly. I want to pick something that has not been touched at all. Okay, Kudra. Ali, you're a man on the firing line. Kudra says, what has FUFA and the Premier League done to engage with government to ensure that more women are supported, the same energy that you've done for men's football? And then he goes on to say, how has FUFA tackled culturally sensitive issues in football to date? I'm still told that football is for boys and it means a girl's dignity. It starts there at the top, engaging government, one. Then the culture sensitivity. This is the culture sensitive issues, something that Rosette spoke about, and I'm going to move from Ali. When Ali responds to the one about government engagement, then Rosette will talk about the things with culture sensitivity of women in sports in general. Ali, you go first.
Of course, Ismail, government issues are not things that you just rush and get them. We always go slow. We are seeing the issue of infrastructure. Infrastructure even in Kampala here. Now in Uganda, you have one stadium which can host international match. If there is an issue with Chitende, just know you are playing a game in Kenya or in Rwanda, anywhere. So government issues always go slow. But when we go there, we also, as we are getting for men, we also get for women. I can tell you the head coaches for women national teams are also put on the payroll where we pay the many coaches. So these opportunities come when we generate a list of players, also generate a list of national team players, women, those who get some money from the government. Then FUFA, we use our funds, and I've just told you, we are one of the organization, our president is one of the leaders who remunerate players. And these players have been getting what they really deserve or what they have worked for. So I believe slowly we can do the government, but also as before we have our initiatives.
Okay. Rosette, culture sensitivities, since you also come with programs from the EU that talk about gender equality and diversity, these culture sensitive issues, what are some of them that you've encountered? You spoke about the one to do with girls who come to play, for example, with Edgar's youth program, and then their friends, fellow girls, leave at some stage, so they are compelled to leave. Mm-hmm. You spoke about girls who are told they are going to lose their chest or their breast because that is the feminine symbol for them. How do we get around these culturally sensitive issues? We want to play the soft sports. Swimming will not change your shape.
Mm.
So go and do that.
Yeah.
You can speak now.
Can I speak? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Thank you. One other thing, of course, like you said, is really a mindset. And we are talking about a mindset in communities, right? In communities, a mindset rural versus urban, a mindset rural versus hard to reach places. How do you get a person from Bundibugyo to try and come and put on a pant, a small thing to when, especially like for athletics, to go and run, or even in football? Yeah. So there is quite a lot that needs to be done in terms of awareness and understanding the inequalities, first and foremost, to understand the inequalities. And these inequalities move from region to region. If you go to Karamoja, issues they are looking at in terms of women's sensitivity or gender responsiveness or women issues that are there for the female, they are totally different. And again, I'll give an example. I don't want to cite anybody else because being a sports person, for example, my issues are different. My daughter's issues are different. And a girl who's going to start sports at a year four, okay, I use maybe any girl now who is about 14 and is a footballer, her issues are different from Lydia. So even as we are giving awareness and trying to understand these things, for as long as we can try to bring out that awareness, that is going to show the community first and foremost. Remember, I said it's very important we involve them using existing structures within the community, be it schools, being these leadership things we have like AOCs, being the small groups that we talked about, using all existing structures just to let them know that, you know, just as you go to converge at 7 p.m. to say Arsenal, we have the small lady Arsenals around us here. And it's us to make these small ladies to become what you want to watch on the TV, okay? So to me, that's one of the starting things. And then there is also something that we need really to understand, that sports now is so commercialized. Everybody thinks they can earn a buck. They can earn some money once they're in sports. And what does that mean? It's not the end. It's not the end. It's very important for us to try and see what were some of the other existing tradition things that we had. Children needed to go to school. How do we try to make sure that they can balance school with sports? You don't have to drop the other one simply because you're going to play. Yeah, there are some parents that I've talked to, and then I advise them and say, yes, it's so good, but please, she needs also the education as well. What happens if she breaks her leg today and then she didn't go to school? Where does that leave her? And then we are looking at this era now, and I'm talking about this period, COVID-19. If you go around your communities, you're going to see how girls and boys have changed, more so the girls, because girls grow faster. Yeah. So what does that mean when they say we want to go on the pitch? And when they go on the pitch, they are going to be laughed at. So that's why I'm saying we go back. We need really to start within our own communities. Let's start in our own homes. If anyone of us has a girl, if anyone has a boy and a girl, try to treat them the same way. If you're going to take them bicycle riding, if you're going to take them jogging, if you're going to play soccer and you think they have, leave express herself, because we don't know where our children are going to earn. It could be that's the avenue where they're going to be earning. Or if you take it alongside other opportunities, like I said, if it's schools, it will be also very good. Then there is something that I also wanted to point out. In this era, especially in Uganda, we have what I call teenage mothers. And there are so many who are really very having a very big talent. I am talking of this because I saw it in NABY. Yeah, I saw it in NABY. And they are very young. They're about 15. They have their children. And my goodness, they have deep talent, which anybody should be able to tap to. But what are some of the stereotypes? That one has a baby. You have a baby, so what? Can't I play football? So that's why I'm saying at the end of the day, this sensitivity have to be addressed right from grassroots, have to be addressed right from our own homes. Yeah, have to be addressed in all the structures that we have in the community, be it circle ladies, being the markets, being whatever, being these border border guys, everybody, if they could really understand and appreciate the way they want to watch Arsenal, could be the same way they can try to bring their own up, more so the ladies, I think we would be able to get there. Thank you.
Thank you, Rosette. You've dribbled all the questions and hit some spikes in there throughout your submission. I'd also like to say we have Angela Nakafero, who is a commissioner in the Ministry of Gender. And these are the people we charge with policy. The things people are saying about policy will probably prompt Angela at some point. Then we also welcome Eunice Tumwebaze. She's the manager of youth and children affairs in KCCA. Eunice, glad to have you in this discussion. They say a lot of questions here. Someone asked Lydia, when did you start playing football? And can you just mention the age? Yes, Lydia?
I was 3 years.
When did you start? You are 3 years. Wow. There is nothing I was doing at the age of 3, maybe crying. So you're way ahead of me. Then there's something about who's going to talk about the inclusiveness of premier skills ideology. At some point, I think someone will tackle that. Angela, I want to invite you very quickly and give you 2 minutes to give us a hint at Minister of Gender level. At a policy level, is the Minister of Gender actually doing anything to get girls involved in so many of these things that are stereotyped to be masculine in our society? Angela?
Thank you very much, Ismail. Really, I'm excited to join this discussion. Very, very interesting. Of course, games and sports is an area that has been...
Angela, could you please switch on your camera? If you're not in a swimming pool.
Come on. Thank you very much. I would like to really thank Emily for mobilizing me. We've just been celebrating the International Day of the Girl Child, and this is part of the discussion that we need to bring in the limelight. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm really excited about this discussion. It was part of my work when I was still working with the Minister of Education and Sports, and we used to challenge the Department of Physical Education to ensure that we bring on board girls in the same way as we're targeting boys to participate in sports and games. So it's an interesting discussion for me. In terms of the policies, ladies and gentlemen, I would want to say that the gender policy of Uganda provides for gender equality in whatever intervention, in whatever initiative that we are supposed to undertake as a country. Though reflecting on what Lydia and Sisons are emphasizing, our engagement in all initiatives of national development have not been even. A lot of focus has been on education, health, agriculture, and of course, we need to step up our game in terms of engaging games and sports for girls. So in my own area, I would want to say that Minister of Gender definitely has a lot of interest in the area of gender equality in games and sports, especially for young people, as this is an important area for skilling. It's an important area for income generation. It's still a very important area in terms of communication for change. There's quite a lot we can use so that we bring about equitable communication. And even the kind of challenges that we are discussing in this meeting of male dominance, we can use sports to challenge male dominance in this country. However, more interest as per the Minister of Gender, Labour, Social Development will be in the area of the young people outside the education system. Of course, all of us know that our education system really makes it almost mandatory for young people to participate in games and different sports. But this is not the same case for young people that unfortunately find themselves out of the school system. So as we talk about sports and athletics in schools, we equally need to talk about games and sports for young people outside the education system. They also talked about sexual harassment, ladies and gentlemen. This is one of our areas of concern as Minister of Gender, Labour and Social Development. And Government of Uganda has already defined laws and policies governing sexual harassment and other forms of gender-based violence. I would want to make an appeal that even cases that are never reported could still be handled within the existing laws and policies of this country. We need to sensitize men and boys in this arena against gender-based violence, because the hand of the law can really catch them, and it can be a disaster, especially for people that are already looked at as celebrities. It can really come up with lots of costs in terms of repetition, but also in terms of the talent that is being promoted. I really like the idea of a multi-sectoral approach It's important that all line ministries come together to promote games and sports in this country. So for me, I think my area of niche will be to really discuss how we can leverage on games and sports in terms of promoting gender equality in this area and in this country. Thank you very much for the time
given. Thank you very much, Angela. Yeah, for joining in. That was quite... I think people should be able to come to the ministry website and access that gender policy. People within the Ministry of Education and Sports should know that already. And that would have a trickle-down effect to the National Council of Sports and then to people like FUFA or FUBA and Uganda Olympic Committee, that gender policy is available and should be accessible. I want to involve three more people in the conversation. They've been listening for the past hour and a half. That's 90 minutes of football. For the time we've been here, first half and second half would be done of a Premier League game. Factor in 15 minutes. And if that game involves one team losing 1-0 like Rwanda did yesterday, I have no problem with that. Miss Natalie Arnold, consultant for culture engagement and inclusive communities at British Council UK. She's going to talk about gender equality through premier skills. Miss Natalie, I've got first of all to give you a lot of credit. You're the most calm and patient panelist today.
I think we'll give that award to the person at the end.
Yeah, if I could give you an hour to speak, but I don't have it. But please take us through what gender equality through premier skills entails. When you come to do these premier skills events or programs, how many girls are you able to raise? Let's start there. Besides the boys.
What was the question? Sorry, how many girls are we trying to engage?
How many girls are able to attend these premier skills events? Because I attended one a few years ago when Premier Skills UK brought Keith Hackett. The former referee was a referee at the 1986 World Cup, for example. How many girls are able to come to these events? Because I didn't see many at the time. And this is when, 2012, when Keith Hackett was in Uganda. When you talk about gender equality through premier skills, how many girls are actually involved in these programs?
Yeah, so I'll go into that in a bit more detail in a bit. I mean, overall, our program target is 50% participation. So we want to have 50% women and girls and 50% men and boys, so that we have that gender equality. But we saw, particularly at the start of the program, that it was much, much lower. So like 20% girls joining in, maybe, and 80% boys. So we've done a lot of initiatives and analysis to find out why that is and to try and address those barriers and things that have got in the way of girls and women being part of Premier Skills specifically. So I can talk through those just now if you'd like me to.
Sure,
yeah.
Go right ahead.
Okay, will do. I'm not sure where Janan is. I'm spotlighting myself because I feel like it's important for people to see me. So what I will do, first of all, thanks for introducing me. Yeah, my name is Natalie Arnold. I work on the Premier Skills Programme. I'm part of the project team based in the UK. So I work with several countries, including Uganda. And I also lead on gender for the Premier Skills Programme. So that's across all of our countries. As with all the other speakers, feel free to add your questions in the chat and we can respond to them either through typing, or I'm sure Ismail will let me know if there's any really challenging ones like we've had previously. For those who don't know, I'm sure you're all aware, but Premier Skills is a partnership between the British Council and the Premier League. So we work with grassroots coaches and referees to help young people find pathways to better lives through football. It started in 2007, and we're currently working with seven countries. Obviously, Uganda is one of them. So what I'll do in the time that I've got, I'll speak about why we think female participation is important, how we've addressed it, and then some of the results that we've had from the initiatives that we set up. So I've mentioned a bit about why we think getting girls and women involved is important. The imbalance of participation was really striking. So in 2013, we only had 20% of female participants, and that's when we started measuring it. So before that, we don't know. It was important to address that for us as a program. We also think that through participating in the program, women and girls get to build their knowledge, their capabilities, their self-esteem, sense of entitlement. And we are working to address their barriers to their participation and empowerment. As you'll see for our next speaker, the Sustainable Development Goals mention gender equality as a global target. So we thought it was really important to include that in our programme. And it's also, from a UK perspective, a priority for the government here, as I'm sure it is for the government in Uganda as well. So what did we do? Well, to start off, we set up a working group to look at, okay, we've got this problem, what are we going to do about it? So that included people from the Premier League and the British Council, and we were deliberately targeting female participation. We made it a theme for our programme, so from 2013 onwards, and set a target of at least 50% female participation across all levels. Then to figure out, okay, why aren't women and girls coming to our sessions? Why aren't they joining in? We actually set about doing a gender analysis for each country. So Emily and Caroline, who work on the program in Uganda, undertook that and found out all sorts of things that are local to Uganda, but also relevant in a kind of global perspective. That might be stopping people joining in. I know that Saison, for example, mentioned quite a few of those in her section. So some things could be childcare issues. If you're a woman with a baby and you can't leave the baby at home, then you maybe need to bring them with you to the session. Maybe the session is timed at the wrong time of day, so the women are not able to come along because they are busy doing things in the home. Also looked at doing separate training sessions for men and women to make sure that women were comfortable with the environment and having a female coach. Showing role models. So Lydia is a great example of this. You know, she's a coach educator now. She's come through our program and she now coaches other coaches, educates other coaches in the country to do football community sessions. So that's really incredible. And another thing on uniform that I thought was really, or kit, I thought was really interesting, that Saison mentioned that. So we had a couple of things come up around that. For example, so we work in some countries in the Middle East, and having sleeves in the shirts was really important for women, so for modesty. And then also, I know that in Uganda, a thing came up around the shorts that we had were white. I think Lydia mentioned, you know, if women are on, or girls are on their periods, they don't want to come to football, they don't want to come to sports, particularly if the clothes that you're wearing might show that you're on your period, they might stain. So we changed our requirements around that so that that wouldn't become an issue. It's such a really small thing, but actually it makes a really big difference. Some other things that we did, so we we've done some training packages for our coaches and coach educators like Lydia, so that they can incorporate that into their sessions and have that as part of the work that they do. So we did a global webinar on gender for everyone in our coach network, and that was followed by individual country webinars to talk about local context. We've developed a more in-depth gender awareness training that was actually trialled in Uganda first of all, and now we've done it in Egypt, and the next country to try it out is Indonesia, so that should be coming up next month. We make a point to mark International Women's Day, and obviously it's great to mark the International Day of the Girl Child as well. So working with our coach network again, we did a call for pledges, and we also had a video chat with Helen Grant, who's the Prime Minister's Special Envoy for Girls' Education. She spoke to some of our female coach educators, which I hope was a great opportunity for them, but also a great opportunity for her to learn about what they're doing and the difference they're making in their countries. So, and then events like today, you know, working with local partners to promote gender equality in sport and the benefits of women and girls playing football. So I'm really pleased to be part of this session, and it's been really amazing to hear different people's experiences and what everyone's doing in their different spheres, all working together for the same goal. So I will briefly tell you about a few of the results of all of those initiatives and the things that we changed. We did manage to increase female participation levels quite substantially. So from, you remember, 20% in 2013, well, last year in 2020, it was 70% women and girls that were in our programs. So it's a huge increase. And I'm really pleased that that's been achieved. Now the challenge is to maintain that and to make sure, obviously 2020 was a strange year for everyone. So make sure that we can continue that good work. We have some great success stories. So in Egypt, for example, in 2018, we launched a partnership with the Ministry of Youth and Sports called 1,000 Girls, 1,000 Dreams, where we've actually engaged now more than 2,000 young girls to play in football games and tournaments. So that's been really impressive. And also in Egypt, we have a Premier Skills coach educator who, a female coach educator who is now the first female coach of a male professional team ever in Egypt. So it's a really, it's an incredible story. She's called Faiza Haider. She's really breaking barriers there. She's great. So just a couple more and then I'll pass back to you. So we have in South Africa, we have a program. There's a coach educator there called Nomonde Mashabane, who she had a job in sports administration, but she did the training and she decided she wanted to work for a company that teaches football in schools. So then she uses the techniques that she learned with Premier Skills to help educate the next generation. And she's also involved in a program that we run called the International Enterprise Program. So teaching them how enterprise and football go together. And then last but not least, obviously in Uganda, we have some amazing examples like Lydia of female role models and people that have gone through the program and are now educating other coaches. Emily shared with me the story of six female Ugandan referees who started in Premier Skills and have now moved their refereeing career to international level or to elite national level. So that's really, really impressive and a great progression. So I'll leave it there. That's a lot of information, but if anyone has questions, then I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Natalie. I think all the ladies here have repeated the thing about periods and the access to menstrual pads, for example. In my village, which is about 3 hours outside of the city center, if you gave out menstrual pads, you'd win an election. So wow. It's not a minor thing, you know?
Yeah.
You're very likely to win an election if you have enough of them to give out all the girls and the your person. It's a very touchy subject, but I almost understand every time I hear the ladies mention it. I know from my home place, you win an election by landslide if you do something like that. I see someone here in the chat room who says he proposes that Ministry of Education adopts a policy to have all schools employ male and female coaches under the public service in Uganda. This is to enforce gender balance and involvement right from schools. Also, FUFA should encourage community positive empowerment in collaboration with local leaders, especially churches and religious institutions. Then DC Football Association should encourage women leaders involved in football administration right from that level. Now, very few women are involved in administration, especially at those levels. I believe FUFA can follow it up structurally. Ali will talk about how they've grown their numbers in terms of women delegates from 3 to 17. Someone here says you can do much, much, much more. Steve, you've been quiet the entire time. I want you to get involved. Steve works with you, he's the director of Soccer Without Borders, and he has a Goal 5, he has a Goal 5 Summit 2021 in Uganda. Steve Davis, if you could please share what this is going to involve before I throw out one question and then allow the country director to wrap this up. Steve, the floor is yours.
Great. Hi, everyone. Thank you for having me. I'm really happy to spend a bit of my International Day of the Girl Child here with you. And I want to give a big shout out to our past panelists who have led some really interesting discussions and shared some wonderful perspectives and experiences in regards to kind of gender equality in sport and their communities and in Uganda. I work with Soccer Without Borders. We are an NGO that works primarily with urban refugee youth that are outside the school system here in Kampala. And rather than focusing on football talent development, we're actually more of a youth development organization. And we work with these youth using football as a tool to teach them how to be stronger members of their communities, also to teach them English and literacy and important life skills, one of which is gender equality, which we teach throughout all aspects of our programming to both our boys and our girls. Our other primary focus area is looking at gender equality in football within Uganda structures, within both competitive football and football for development. And I want to share a little bit about our upcoming project called the Uganda Goal 5 Summit with you today. This is the latest in a series of these projects we've done over the last 4 years. And when we do these projects, we focus on kind of three levels of gender equality. The first level is on the field. And the concept of this is at your participant or player level. And the goal is just getting more girls in the game. Through recruitment, through safe spaces, through how you're designing your sessions and your activities. The second space is on the sidelines, and this is the focus of supporting and emboldening female coaches on and off the football pitch. And then the third phase is in organizations. So this can be your competitive football academies, your sport for development organizations, your community teams. But looking at gender equality and gender balance within decision-making roles in these organizations. So for this project, our focus is on all three of these. And one thing we have really seen a lot of over the last couple of years is some really amazing growth in Uganda at the field level. From the community perspective, in our community and the partner communities that we work in, we've seen huge growth in Uganda in girls' football participation. Where there used to be maybe one girls' team or two girls' teams competing against boys, we're seeing 6, 7, 10 teams popping up now, regularly training, playing, and it's really amazing. But as we're seeing this, we're also seeing that on the sidelines and in the organization portions are not keeping pace. So when you see these teams, they're all coached by men. The money, the decision-making, everything is also generally controlled by men. So with these projects, we want to focus on how can we address those areas too. So starting in about a week here, we're hosting the Uganda Goal 5 Summit in partnership with the British Council and the Premier League and with some support from FUFA and Glorious Foundation. And this summit is going to be focused specifically for women. And we will have a 1 week long coaching workshop at the FUFA Technical Center in Njeru, and a residential camp for the women each night at a lovely campsite on the banks of the Nile in Jinja, and provide an opportunity for, I believe we have 42 women now from 18 football academies and sport for development organizations in 10 different districts in Uganda, including 5 different refugee communities, to learn from each other, to learn from professional instructors from the British Council and the Premier Skills Program, to learn from our experienced staff here off the field and our experiences working at the community level and with grassroots football, and mostly to create a network to support each other. So that will be the primary activity. As I said, that's going to largely address kind of the on the sidelines target that we have. It will indirectly address on the pitch too, because these are women that are going to go back to their communities with what they've learned, work with girls, work with some boys too, I'm sure, and implement these things. However, one thing we've learned when doing football trainings, and particularly football trainings for women, is that a few issues arise after the training. And one of the common issues is that a lot of women learn these skills, are highly motivated, are highly talented, have great capacity to implement these sessions, but they go back to their teams, they go back to their communities, they go back to their organizations and academies, and they aren't given the chance to actually lead what they've learned and implement what they've learned. Most of these organizations, academies, communities are led by men. And while many of these men have great intentions, it does not often provide the space and the encouragement and the resources needed for these women to succeed in implementing what they've learned and continue growing in these roles. So the last part of this School 5 Summit is going to be a chance to bring in some of these organization leaders, academy leaders, and have discussions about gender equality and what gender equality means on the pitch, on the sidelines, and within our own organizations. And I, speaking from experience of Soccer Without Borders, we all have lots of space to grow in these areas and a lot more to understand about how to support the women and girls in our programs and on our staffs and on our leadership teams. So in this training, we will introduce a couple different tools we have, such as a gender self-assessment and a gender action plan, and just kind of open up the discussion to all of these leaders to maybe think a bit differently and really encourage our women to be successful and continue growing and want to grow in these programs. The final part of the summit will be after. So after this training week, everyone will go back to their communities, back to their organizations. And we're giving a chance for all of the young women to lead, to write, Goal 5 project proposals. And we'll fund 6 to 8 of these proposals for these women to then implement and lead within their communities and support gender equality with their teams and with their coworkers at the community level. So yeah, I think one of the last things I just wanted to say, I heard the term role models come up a couple times throughout some of the other discussions. And at Soccer Without Borders, that has become a really important thing for us, the concept of creating role models. And when it comes to gender equality and when it comes to girls, we think it's really important for them to be able to see role models on the pitch with them, on the sidelines, coaching and supporting them, and also in the management decisions, whether it's in an organization or at a community level, seeing some of that in the power structure. And there's kind of a simple phrase we used in one of our past projects, but kind of the term, if she can see it, she can be it. And it's kind of a simple but a fun way to think about it, that if we can help create these role models for girls, it's going to build up the next generation so that hopefully this issue will not be around or not be as serious for them.
Oh, thank you, Steve. And hope that our program is a success, and hopefully you invite us for Uganda Goal 5 Summit, because then we'd love to attend. You know, in the chat room, there's a lot of questions. FUFA Deputy CEO, I would love to pass on one question, if you're still there, Mr. Humphrey Mandu, to support Ali. The plans you have in place to overcome the many hurdles and make football secure for women at board level, because as Deputy CEO, you must be dealing with this thing. Humphrey?
Hello? You hear me?
Yes, Humphrey. Switch on your camera, please, and tell us what you're doing to make football environment secure for women.
Thank you so much, Mr. Moderator. Just jumped out of a workshop where we are having a retreat for strategic planning for the next 4 years for FUFA football in Uganda as a whole. However, because of the importance of this engagement, I've reserved time to come out and ensure that we talk to the general stakeholders. I'd like to extend my thanks to all of you and the organizers. For the matter of this, going to your question, as FUFA, we are various on ensuring we support women football in all aspects. And this has been one of the key pillars in the manifesto and the strategic plan of the federation and the government, running government at hand in the federation. As I speak now, we already have a woman football officer who was recruited some years ago and has a specific function of promoting and identifying and generating policies that have been set to ensure that youth football at the level of women and girls is enhanced in Uganda and has gone down to the grassroots. Just like we partner with different stakeholders, like British Council, activities that they carry on. And as a federation, we are happy always to join hands and put support where it is possible. So we have a deliberate policy to promote girl football, and we are very strong on this. And the executive committee has policies that are set. And we have a full-time staff that is always doing and thinking for women and football. Lastly, we have a functional football development department, which is headed by none other than Mr. Ali Mwewe, who is the director for development. And under this segment, there are a lot of training that are being taking place. There's youth development, coaching of young people or young people who are active, want to do a lot of coaching at that level. So ideally, you see that we have a robust system and a method of ensuring we achieve the girl-child dream in Uganda in terms of football promotion.
Oh, thank you, Humphrey, for that submission. We may not be able to respond to all the questions because there's a lot of them, but we are coming to the end. I'd like to invite the person who is in charge of ensuring that British Council continue to do this kind of programs in Uganda. Mr. Chilufya Besa, I hope I've pronounced that right. It's the time for you to deliver the closing remarks. And also, I'd like for you to handle the final part of this Premier Skills engagement, which is a call to action to the invited guests. Mr. Chilufya Besa, I'm trying that a second. Maybe I'll try it that time, and I'll be perfect. But you can't pronounce my name, right? So I'm allowed to struggle to pronounce yours.
Well, I think you got it right. Thank you very much, Ismail. Thank you very much, first of all, to you for the great managing this whole panel. I think you've done a really wonderful job in ensuring that all the voices have been heard. So thank you very much. On this great day of the International Day of the Girl Child, it's really good that we're here together to discuss this very important topic of advancing female participation in football. And I have heard some really great views from all the people that have, the various participants that have spoken here. And I think I really like the passion that I heard from the women themselves. Lydia was really passionate when she put through her views on what hindrances are there for female participation. It's various things like the sexual exploitation that she talked about. I think that that's a very serious issue that hinders female participation. And it was really, really brave of you, Lydia, to come out and be able to be forthright and upfront about your own personal experiences. So credit to you on that. So I just want to talk a little bit about the British Council and why the focus on women and girls. Well, for us at the British Council, we believe that empowering women and girls and achieving gender equality is crucial to creating inclusive, open, and prosperous societies. Gender inequalities, we realize, however, do persist in many countries, and it's not just in Uganda. I think we heard from Rebecca earlier on when she said that there is only 7% of referees in the UK that are female. That is worrying from our perspective, but it's also a source of encouragement because it shows that Uganda is not alone in this space. So we can share ideas. How are people in the UK doing this, and how can we take some of that learning and bring it to Uganda? So one way we do that as British Council, obviously, is by bringing together different actors, the people that are in the UK to share their perspectives, as well as Ugandans right here who are involved, people like Mayor, who's been there and done it all, okay? So this panel discussion has been really enlightening for me personally. I have two daughters, and I hope that opportunities are created for them to be able to do whatever it is that they want to do, whether that's football or another sport. When I was growing up myself, football was very much a male domain. In primary school, where I went to primary school, boys played football, girls played netball. That's just the way it was, and no one challenged that. So I'm really glad that right now we're talking, we're having various conversations about how we can advance female participation in sport and bring about that equality. And I think that by bringing together such a diverse cast of actors that are involved in female in football in Uganda, we can finally solve this problem. We have Angela Nakafero, the Commissioner for Gender and Women in Sport in the Ministry of Labour and Social Development. that ensures that we're able to reach even at the level of policy decision making. Mr. Humphrey Mandu, I heard you talk about what we're about what FUFA is doing to advance female participation. That's really important for us as the British Council, and I hope that this is something that we're going to continue in to ensure that women participation in football, which is an area that has been neglected for so long, finally gets the due attention. From the British Council, I can say that we'll continue pushing this because we realize that the benefits of female empowerment are massive. A lot of you will be familiar with the African proverb that goes that if you educate a man, you educate an individual. But if you educate a woman, you educate a family or a nation. And really, this is what we want to see. We want to see empowered women out there. Okay, we just don't want small roles for them. Working together with the Premier League, Soccer Without Borders and FUFA, we'll continue making it a focus so that we see enough women on the pitch, on the sidelines, and more importantly, in the boardroom. Thank you very much.
Thank you, our country director, for those empowering closing remarks that touched some of the things that were discussed today. I've been directed by my contacts, Emily and Caroline, to end this. I'm glad to be part of this, passionate about. I'm part of the Media House, the Nation Media Group. We run Daily Monitor, we run NTV, KFM, and MFM, and Nyanda, some in English, and the others are in Luganda. One of the things that I've learned over time is that even us media houses will probably subconsciously forget how much space we give women in sport. But we've taken it upon ourselves, and I can comfortably say we've improved tremendously. Maybe those who are involved in sport here can attest to that. When you've seen, we've had women's football, for example, as our lead story on the back page. We've had women's cricket, we've had volleyball. We have volleyball, for example, tomorrow for women. Ndeje were playing somewhere in Kabale in the southwestern Uganda and won a tournament there. And we find those as very important. For example, we've also had Husna Kukundakwe, the paraswimmer who has one arm and she was competing at the Tokyo 2020 Olympics. And we find those things extremely important. And I hope that after this discussion, we take this gospel. I'm Muslim, but let's use the word gospel for this. We take this gospel to our communities and hopefully British Council can share with us a document to remind us about what we've discussed today, and that will be very important for all the panelists in here and the guests we've had to be able to carry forward what they've had, learned, and what they've shared in this conversation. I'd like to thank you very much, all the participants, and may you have a wonderful evening. Thank you.